The expert presenter, Dr. Ramesh K. And he is a senior scientist from Wildlife Institute of India and adjunct professor, University of British Columbia, Canada. His area of expertise are many. Some of them are landscape ecology, conservation of mammals and birds, landscape dynamic, conflict resolution mechanisms, conservation, breeding, and reintroduction. Dr. Ramesh has published more than 50 research articles, and he's sharing and giving lectures on human dimensions of wildlife management. I hope these topics will also be very interesting because we have a direct link with wildlife. So Dr. Ramesh, please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Chairperson.
Dear Ramesh, I just take 2 minutes before. Yeah, you are here. Hello, after a long, long time, we are meeting. Ramesh.
Yes, I think
Dr. Ramesh, yes, you listening me, yes. Let me share with everyone that Dr. Ramesh is our very, 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 very old friend. So we were together, we joined Wildlife Institute of India in 1995. And we were together in a team in Great Himalayan National Park and doing their research. Although, because of my rebellious nature, I quit it within a year. And Ramesh continued with the Wildlife Institute. Not only that particular project supported by the World Bank, this was very, very flagship project, and he successfully did, and then he sustained with the Wildlife Institute, and today he's one of the prominent scientists there. And let me share about Ramesh, because Ramesh used to be, that time we were young, and then Ramesh used to be a kind of leopard or tiger. You know, he had to jump onto the high hills of 3,000, 4,000 meters. So this is just one note. And before that, Maria and Ole were presenting. Let me tell you, this program had to happen at their national park, Ustul China, probably I'm not pronouncing very well, national park in Kosiv. Kosiv is a very, very well-known place, known for Hutsul ethnic group. And I used to be there, fortunately, and I had visited this area, particularly the villages, but not this office of this national park, but the director of the national park is our friend. So this particular program had to happen there. And Dr. Ramesh was to deliver this, to coordinate this wildlife and biodiversity theme, today's themes. But we know that this program could not happen there. Another speaker, Dr. Alexandre, is also a very old friend, and he is heading the very key protected area in Ukraine, that is Carpathian National Park. And I used to be there, met him, discussed with him, and that is beautiful valley which is called Yaremche. And probably in 2023, I mean after 2 years, this same program will happen there. And Dr. Ole, or the National Carpathian National Park, probably the very active player in it. Thank you, taking these 2 minutes, and now time is yours, Dr. Ramesh.
Thank you so much for this initial introduction to the chairperson and to Dr. Asrath. I think I feel very privileged to be part of this esteemed course. I see this program, I see this expert, I've been listening on and off and also on the social media. I think it's one of the excellent coordinated program. I congratulate each one of you who's coordinated, organized, provided space, and also the participants. So I think, as Dr. Asrath said, I think my journey started from the Himalayas. I'm so glad I'm reconnecting within the same journey. So I share my presentation. I want some of you, maybe if you can just see if it is visible, and it is rolling. Is it rolling? Or it's the first page?
No, because it is what it is working well. You please go ahead.
Okay, super. So my discussion or the inputs in this particular course would be to discuss the human dimension of wildlife management. So taking, I mean, human dimension is a huge subject. In fact, if you talk about wildlife management, I would say, except the protection within the bounds of the protected area or any national parks or reserves that we needed to manage, but most of it is actually human management. So the human dimension, even though it may not be very explicit when you see it, and it is the core of the wildlife management. So, but then of these issues, which are very, very prominent or important for people to take note of or act upon, is looking at the interface activities, mostly the conflict. I think people coming from Nepal and Bhutan, other parts of South Asia would very well be able to appreciate the kind of interference, even for that matter in Europe and other parts of the world. I think the coexistent or conflict management strategies are very important one. So in fact, I wanted to kind of flag this, starting with the, how the conflict is kind of visualized and where we go from here in the future. I mean, in fact, this is the key subject area globally, because this is going to be one of the determinants of nature conservation and also the way the human life is going to be. Even if you take this, the COVID or any pandemic, the root actually comes from the interface. So to give you the perspective to this, the human wildlife conflict is generally defined as a situation when the needs and behavior of wildlife impact negatively on the goals of human, or when the goals of human negatively impact the needs of wildlife. So it's basically the statement that's come from the World Parks Congress 23. So that puts the kind of how the situation, which is a kind of coexistence situation, can become a conflict. But in the context of India, I think India is an excellent example to portray this whole issue, because you have multitude of species, you will know as I move along with this presentation. Human wildlife conflict has been recognized as one of the major threats to wildlife in India. So even if you look at the working group on wildlife, ecotourism, and animal welfare, and it's also one of the important themes for the 12th five-year plan period of the country. It's also one of the chapters of India's National Wildlife Action Plan, which is running from 2017 to 2031. So this basically tells you how this particular issue is important to us in terms of understanding and managing. These are the species that we deal with in terms of potential conflict species or actual conflict species. Starting with the elephant, then leopard. You have herbivores like nilgai or bulbul, what we call them, or wild pig, macaque, sloth bear, bears. I mean, I think high altitude, you have other bear species, and even snow leopard. So these are the potential species that we need to deal with when you're talking about human-wildlife interface and the aspects of the human into wildlife management. Because it is not just an incident about what happens to the people or to the property or to the animal, but the whole conservation discourse is actually driven by the way we manage this aspect of human dimension. Because other aspects of human dimension, such as firewood collection or their livelihood activities, they are much easier to handle in terms of the response from the people, the resource requirement, but here, the response needed to be immediate and effective. Yeah. So to give you the background, look at the human elephant conflict case that's happening, because we call this a mammoth concern. It's a huge concern. And number of death caused by elephant, of human, you can see the statistics, which is running over 2000. I mean, this is probably slightly underestimated. So about 2000. And reversely, if what actually the kind of elephant deaths from a people is about 373, I mean, which includes electrocution, accidents, other things. I mean, there are a lot of other human mediated causes. When it comes to tiger, I mean, we all know tiger is one of the three most conflict prone large bodied felids in the world. I mean, this is resulting in a population decline by 50% in some of the states. I mean, this is a statistic that we see from. I mean, you can imagine how people can get after and kind of react in a situation that one wouldn't even imagine people will be able to take that kind of extreme steps. That's because you have a background again. If you look at this whole past 1800 to 2009, that some of the well-developed countries, including Singapore, probably we had so many of the issues in the past, but now we don't have tigers in many of the places. You see this graph, which really depicts the kind of death that has taken place. No, how no tiger or other, I mean, particularly here, the tiger is killing a human. So these statistics tells us why we lost so much of, you know, range and the species in many of these countries, starting from Singapore, Indonesia, India, Nepal, all those countries. So you can also see the death, unnatural death and the total death when it comes to human-tiger conflict. So you see, I mean, this is statistics up to 2018. This has been gradually increasing, and that's one of the major factors which is going to decide. Tiger conflict is other major peculiar or very frustrating problem because leopard is a very, very adaptable species. The line separating, I mean, interestingly, the line separating wilderness and civilization is getting blurred increasingly. And this, the leopard live in this blur continuum. Basically, what it means is the continuum space between the forest and the urban, I think this short boundary is no more existing. It's getting blurred now. Because of the blur, leopard does not actually know what it is happening. So mostly they get into the human areas. Because of the high level of behavioral plasticity coupled with wider prey base and adaptability to survive in a range of novel ecosystem, the leopard is most often implicated in attacks on people. So this is something that we have to take note of. It's happening all over wherever leopard exists. So add to that, we have a recent estimate coming from India. The leopard population is actually going up, and we have about, the density of leopard is also getting into very high across country. We are even talking about minimum of 12,000 leopards in the protected area. There could be much more leopards in the country. Okay. So this distribution can tell you how leopard and so the conflict again, it's you can see this number of conflict incidences between the human and leopard is not maybe seeing any trend, but then you can see this consistency in terms of the number. And there are peaks in some years, but this is there. But on an average, it's more than 100, which is not a small. So people, and I think the interface is very important, basically, because I would say this whole issue of the interaction, because for any conservation effort to succeed, because it is important to have the support of local communities. Because they are the one who are closer to the nature and they are the one who are interacting much more. But people's support to conservation is lost. I mean, this is the point that I was trying to make in the first line. It is not just an aspect of human wildlife conflict, but I think the whole human dimension to the overall wildlife management conservation can be influenced or negatively influenced by the way the conflict is managed. Because the moment people lose faith, because most of the time it happens through the conflict, then you lose the support for entire conservation. Because cost of conservation is primarily borne by local communities in form of not only livestock loss due to conflict, but also livelihood loss due to increased restriction accessing forest resources. So people generally have the frustration for being limited in what they have been doing historically. Add to that, even these animals venture out of the forest and make damage. Therefore, it becomes a completely frustrating situation for people, and the tolerance limit goes down. We have done some of the recent studies with our own students. We've been able to demonstrate very clearly that people's perception towards these forests and people. So they're so good with forests. They are comfortably supporting forests. But when it comes to conflict animal, they don't. So it's a kind of differentiation they're able to make between the forest conservation and animal conservation. So if you don't deal with the animal conservation properly, then you're going to lose the whole conservation support for the entire forest. So this is what happens. If people are not, taken on board, if their concerns are not addressed, so they actually have elephant getting killed. I mean, these are some of the scenes which you never want to see, but this is there. And these are other things. So what people can do, these are real. These are the pictures that are seen, happening in many parts of the country. If you don't deal with them, so people might actually have so much problem. So basically, having understood this, some of this background, so we needed to really see what are the key drivers of conflict. So these three points are very important. Any of the students who are listening to this talk, please try to internalize this. The reason being, in any situation, when you're trying to understand human dimension or human-wildlife conflict, so these factors becomes very prominent. Very often, we tend to overlook or address one of it. That is why even today, the human-wildlife conflict issues is a persistent problem across board, particularly in the mountain system. So landscape configuration change. I think mountain systems are, that it's much more complex system and the interspersions are very high and the blurred nature of rural and forest is also high. Therefore, it's very important for us to understand the landscape configuration and change because the interface areas are increasing with the significant impacts of people and animals. Because there are class, we have a case study that I will demonstrate how people are able to pursue this and things can change if we deal with this, the landscape configuration and change aspect. The other one is the biological socioeconomic imperatives. Because intrinsic characteristics of animals and livelihood concerns of people pushes the boundaries of threshold and manifests into push factors and pull factors. So basically the intrinsic factors which we are basically talking about, which binds together animal and people's livelihood. So that is something that we need to see. The last and most important, which often been ignored, rather kind of not given the due attention, is the attitudes and behavior of people and animals, okay? See, human-wildlife conflict or interface is seen as more of a population level problem. It is true when you look at the interface and the blurriness that I'm talking about. There are also individual problems which might kind of give a wrong impression it's a population problem. So what I mean here is there are aberrant individuals of animal, there are aberrant individuals of people. If they don't behave in a manner that they should be able to do, because in most situations, whether it's human, whether it's an animal, they tend to avoid the conflict. But these aberrant individuals, which basically pushes the boundary and causes impact, which again brings a very different consequences, because the response then becomes more negative. I take you from there. I want you to take note of this particular things. What are the drivers? So you look at the biological drivers, you look at the socioeconomic drivers. Among the biological drivers, it is an intrinsic requirement of these animals, whether it be tiger, leopard, all the high altitude species which are interface with human. So that include the most basic requirements, the prey or forage density, availability. Then their space, cover, and water, and their own social dynamic problems. For example, if a large carnivore is there, after 2 years, they will disperse. So if you say an animal is actually moving from one area to other, it is not a problem animal. It is the intrinsic nature of this animal's social system. So they needed to disperse after 2 years. Therefore, they come out. So it cannot be compared with an animal which is aggressively coming to human habitation. Because even though you may have excellent forage or prey density for carnivores inside the forest, they are forced because of the social dynamics. People tend to misunderstand this. They say, oh, because animals are coming outside because there is no forage inside. It's not the case. There is everything available inside. But just that the social system, the social behavior pushes these animals to be outside. So they are forced to fend for their own resources. That causes sometimes misunderstanding, conflict management. Then we have the anthropogenic activities. So people then go and then try to utilize the resources. So that time, the response to this anthropogenic activity. Again, it's a kind of an innate response each animal have. Then from the socioeconomic drivers, this is purely from the people perspective. Why would people really want to go in support? In any given situation, everybody want to be in a much more comfortable situation, but still people are there. So you have to understand that the socioeconomic status. It is also means that people have the historical connection to the space. It's a site fidelity is one. Okay. Then way the distribution of the settlements occur, the spatial distribution is important. Then look at the economics of the communities and what kind of resources they extract from nature. And the belief and attitude towards carnivores. Okay. And then psychological parameters, both actual economic laws as well as perceived law. So all these parameters put together makes a driver. So it is sometimes it could be one of the factors, sometimes it could be a combination of the factors. So all of them have to be understood if you really wanted to resolve this human, you know, the issues when it comes to the conservation management. Only then we can come up with the conflict resolution strategies. So just to give you a few case studies, I mean, as example, this is one of the studies that was done in the Great Himalaya part of the Uttarakhand, where we tried to understand one of an MSc student who's actually going to be studying human-elephant interface in Europe. So she was actually trying to document what is happening in that particular part. So she put out a camera trap, she tried to document, and she got 16 species which are actually living in the interface areas. Yeah. So what she got at the end is this. Animals are there in the human-dominated area. So what mediates the human, you know, dominated area? What are the basically factors that the mediates? So she found that it's basically the usage pattern was governed by food resources to distribute closer by, and also the tolerance level of the people. Okay, so kind of this is a currently is a win-win situation, but then she went further and asking how the people view now, whether this response would change later. Okay, but then the answer was yes, tolerance do exist, because currently the status quo which both animal as well as people have allowing both to exist. If this change, if any alteration in current land use pattern change, or if there is any population increase in the wildlife population happens, I think this the delicate balance may be affected. And then you start seeing what you currently see as a coexistence can become a conflict. So tiger population again is an example which I'm just leading to what I said about tiger population increase. We are very happy about doubling the tiger. It's a global agenda. India has already achieved much before than what it was supposed to be. So doubling the global agenda is done through combination by the government. I think the government led from the front and with support of NGOs and individuals. So with the number has come, but which also means that, you know, there could be a problem. So there are places we have started seeing more conflict that was not happening before. And then in situations like where we lost tigers, we have tried to reintroduce tigers. So tigers are bouncing back in places where the population was low intensity, even historically, and making more efforts to make them come back. Okay, so this is a very classic picture. You can see is from one camera trap, you've seen tiger and livestock and people. You can note this time. So on same day, actually in a very short span of time. So which basically means the space is occupied by all three group. So obviously, if the conflict is not happening, so there is something that is being done. So whether how people are managing. So we try to do question analysis. This is again a PhD work of one of my students. So trying to understand their perception over in 25 villages and sampling about 20% with 33 households. And in general, education, community, household income, and total livestock owned are important variables that are affecting negative attitudes of people towards tiger. So therefore, increase in education and wealth of household would lead to decrease in negative opinion towards tiger. This is what the lesson is. On the other hand, increasing number of livestock owned would increase negative opinion. These are very, very, you know, plausible explanation that's coming through out of the study. So these are elements that we needed to focus. Because if you don't take care of them, so the death for a tiger will happen, because this is what has happened on one of our reintroduced tiger population site. Again, focusing on those whole, the sequence. So when you do a tiger population recovery, and this is the conflict that will happen, then you need to look at negligence, then it's a loop. So the loop needed to be understood and addressed properly. So the other one where we have another case study, what factors influencing people's response to a tiger translocation in the eastern part of India. So we did a very extensive assessment of the people and found the people have totally comfortable response to, okay, they have the importance of forest conservation is necessary, they've realized it. But when you talk about wildlife conservation, so forests, yes, more or less, people have, absolutely, you can see this number of samples, it's huge, but they accepted it. But when it comes to wildlife conservation, you start seeing the mixed response. Some say, yes, it's fine. Some say, maybe not. But when you say specifically some of this conflict species, you see the no becoming more emphatic. So this is something that we need to take note. This no is not a simple no about the species. This no is an indication as to what might happen to your overall conservation. So what they said, forest conservation important, if you don't take care of this, then the whole negative response, which is currently positive, can become a negative response. We have a similar case of leopard conflict in the other mountain range, the Shivalik forest range. So we had experience of reported human cases, and we had studied looking at the camera traps. These bubbles are actually the number of unique leopards that have been captured in the camera traps. And we looked at this behavior, and you see this very clearly. The leopards' behavior in non-conflict zone, they're very, very gentle. The peaks are not very prominent. Whereas in the conflict zone, the peak is very prominent towards the darker side, the nighttime. So, which means the leopards are generally, they're trying to avoid, which again amplified here in this graph between human and the leopard. So in a non-conflict zone, I think that's the overlap is there, because this is mostly the forest guards and all. But in conflict zone, they tend to avoid. The overlap is completely negative, which again tells us that, you know, these animals do learn and they understand, they try to negotiate. It is probably the human behavior that is basically causing the damage. So we also have another study where we try to capture leopard, which are coming to human interface areas, and put a satellite transmitters and, you know, translocate many places. So we invariably could see these leopards come back to those old original places without causing more damage. So therefore, in a places where they're able to negotiate or they have this familiarity of, you know, the land users, they're able to manage. There are lots and lots of such animals live in the proximity to human. So we just needed to understand how they manage and co-manage this whole situation. So other classic example is about elephant. So there's one elephant caused human death. On the other side of the Ganges, it's again the foothills of the Himalayas. So this leopard was caught. I mean, this is a description of the leopard, and it had a series of events. This is a sequence event. So this leopard was actually caught on this portion, the western part of the portion, and got translocated in the eastern part. Okay. These are the sequence of action that happened, capture to bring them and load them, and then release and put the radio collar and release these animals, okay? And then we see the situation here. So after release, they've been roaming around on the eastern part, but then one fine day, it crossed over and came back here. So some of the time, whatever effort that we do, it may be a problem that the animals come back and again cause damage. So this particular animal was caught and then kept in a captivity. So basically, what I mean to say here is, so capture, relocation may not be the solution, but then these are some of the action. So we cannot say, just because I demonstrated these two classic examples about leopard and elephant, they come back after being translocated, does not mean that, no, we don't need to do it. It basically tells us these animals can come back, but therefore you manage them. But at the same time, in terms of conflict situation, you needed to really react. Otherwise, people will react. So as a professionals, we needed to plan. So in terms of long-term management for the elephant, there are a list of things that has been looked at, including technological solution, things like that. So to kind of summarize or to give you a kind of, you know, pointer forward, I would say the whole human dimension needed to be understood from these three perspectives. There's a crisis perspective, which is a crisis situation where you need to address immediately. There's a short-term situation. There's a long-term situation. In terms of the methods that we adopt, so there are categories. There are physical methods where you try to really stop, create defenses and things like that. There are biological methods. We start using pheromones or use population control. The psychological methods, these are both applicable to human and people. Psychology methods where you inside, you talk about, teach them and change the perception. Other side, try to create the fear factor to this animal. And the last one, to create early warning system to both animal and people. So if you do all this, I think we are probably in a position to deal with them. Because in terms of the physical method and the lot of options people have been trying, so some include physical barrier. You create a physical barrier, erecting wall. Sometimes you create a barrier through, you know, your, electric fences. Sometimes you use sensor network to wade off. And now we have a lot of other technology that has come. People are setting up a virtual fences through honeybees and things like that. But these are some of the physical methods that you actually use. Biological methods are basically partly successful, partly under trial. It is happening some places. But I think psychological methods does provide a lot of leeway. We can really work around, okay? Because that helps us to get into the next level, early warning system. The psychological method, early warning can work together.
Dr. Ramesh?
I'm finishing, yeah. So basically,
thank you.
So basically, this is what is kind of finally comes into. If you don't do this, this situation may happen, but it is not the only situation that we always see, and these situations also happen. Okay, so thank you so much for basically listening to this, and I can tell you this future forward will be to generally see the coexistence agenda can be promoted, and ultimately human dimension has to be a co-management strategies. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I end my presentation here. I think I still have 2 minutes for question.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Ramesh. It's wonderful. And you have a clear pictures. And this is the major concerns worldwide, the conflict, the human and wildlife. This is very interesting. And you have shown some case study that happens globally, the conflict. Even in Nepal, we have many cases of conflicts. And for conservations, how we can minimize the conflict. This is the major concerns, and one of the major that you got successful on translocations that helps to reduce the conflict and to manage. I also saw some chat box and your lecture. Many attendees have mentioned this lecture was very good and practically useful, and even raised some issue how we can minimize the conflict. Thanks once again, Dr. Ramesh, and whole, I think the participants, if they have questions, they will communicate through email and as well as chat box or his personal email. Thanks, Dr. Ramesh.
Thank you, everyone.
All dear participants.